Good morning, everyone. Happy Easter. You can have a seat for a second. My name is Juan, if I haven't had the chance to personally meet you yet. And as one of the pastors here at Evolve, I got to tell you, you guys look good this morning. Before you leave, make sure you're taking a picture out by the photo booth with you and your beautiful families. We would love to see them on social media this week. Let me take a second to thank those joining us online. We are grateful for you as well. We would love to know where you're viewing from and get to know your name, so you could drop that in the chat, and we would love to connect with you. We're actually going to put an opportunity to connect in the chat as well. We would love to do that with you. Now, if this is your first time joining us, I want to extend a special welcome to you this morning. You picked a great morning as we celebrate this morning to be here. And my prayer is that God speaks to you in only ways that he can, and that you would feel it, you would see it, and you would receive it this morning. You are not here by accident. And so we're glad that you're here this morning. We would actually love to get to know your name and to know that you were here. We don't want to miss anyone. And so there's a couple ways that you could connect this morning. One, there's actually a pamphlet in front of you. You could just easily fill that out and put it in one of the boxes around the room. Or if you're tech savvy, the easiest way to do it is to simply text NEXT to 40777. Now, I want to take a second to personally invite you to a great service that we have coming up this week with our FCA baptism service that we have going on Saturday, April 6th. We have been chosen to host the FCA, which is the Florida Christian Athletics service. We've been attending all year with the Ocoee High School students, and some of those students have heard the gospel and received it and are taking their next steps in baptism. And so I think it would be a great opportunity for us as the church to simply surround them with love and to meet them and to celebrate with them as their students take their next steps. And if you can't make it, man, there's another thing you could do. It's just to simply pray. Pray that God would continue to move. We have 1 week left to register students. And so just pray that God would continue to move in the hearts of the students so that they would take their next steps. And if you're sitting here in this room, and if you've been thinking about baptism, thinking about taking that next step, man, we would love to partner with you. If you hear the message today, the celebration message, that God has conquered the grave, and it speaks to you in a way that you have to take a next step, we want to celebrate with you, and we want to guide you and direct you and make that next step as easy as possible. And so all you have to do is simply text the words NEXT to 40777, check baptism, and we will get back with you and celebrate with you as well next week. You know, baptism is just another step that we take in following Jesus. It's simply responding to what he's done for us, receiving that love that he has given us. Another way that we take a step is simply by our giving here. Giving is just a simple way to say, God, I love you, I trust you, I love you, I'm gonna follow you, and I even trust you with my money, my finances, something that's really tough to do and this age. And if this is your first time here, please feel, don't be obligated to feel like you have to give this morning. We're just glad that you're here and you're able to hear the message. But if you want to take that next step in giving this morning, there's many ways you can do so. There's boxes around the room, or you can simply text GIVE to 40777. Now I'm done. We're going to continue to celebrate. But before we do, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you and we are so grateful for what you've done for us conquering the grave. As we continue to worship you through song and by the hearing of your word, we just ask that your spirit be revealed to us in ways that we could easily see it, feel it, take a next step, and to be in your presence this morning. We love you, Lord. Let's continue to celebrate. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's continue to worship this morning.
Darkness, we were waiting without hope and without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle. Salvation, Jesus, for our Savior died. stones moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. You sing, and the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame.
Hallelujah.
Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel and shall not fade. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom we are free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Sing it out nice and loud. Praise him this morning. Come on.
The morning sunrise, the women at the tomb, the shaking ground, the stone removed. This is Easter. The flash of lightning, the angel's testimony, the promise of Jesus, the empty grave. This is Easter. A day to hope against all odds. A day to worship our living God. A day to believe in the power of Jesus. A day to celebrate and a day to remember. The curse is broken. The promise is true. The tomb is empty. The King is alive. This is Easter.
Well, good morning and happy Easter. I am so glad that we can celebrate together. He is risen, right? We can say that he is risen. We can celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And it's so good to be together today as the body, as the church, to celebrate together. Man, it gets me excited. And as I was thinking about today, the one thing that I wanted to be able to help us do was to actually experience more of the joy of the resurrection. I want us to really dig in. I want us to experience that in ways that maybe we never have before. And as I was thinking about that, I really was thinking that it's impossible to experience the joy of the resurrection without knowing the tragedy of death. It's impossible to do that. What I've experienced in my life is that in order for the positive things, the good things in my life, to really experience those to their full, I kind of have to know the bad news. I kind of have to know the negative. In order for that to really kind of be accentuated, the good and positive things in my life. That's what I've come to find out in all of my experiences. One of those experiences I want to share with you this morning. It has to do with my son, my youngest son, Wyatt. In fact, there's a picture with him there this today. This is not him today. He's grown up a little bit. This was several years ago. But I'm gonna show you this picture because that's about roughly, maybe he was a little bit older than that, but it's about roughly the age that he was in the story that I want to share with you this morning. You see, a few years ago, our family decided to go and to just have a good fun day at a local water park. And so we rounded up our five kids and Bonnie and I and our good friends Chad and Sandra, and we all went to the water park. We thought, man, it's going to be an incredible day. It's going to be great. And it was. We were having all kinds of fun. And as we were making our way through the park and experiencing different things, we were moving from one ride to the next. And as we were doing that, as we were walking along, all of a sudden we realized that my youngest son, Wyatt, wasn't with us. And it scared us to death, as you can imagine. Any parent, you're like, where is our child? We started to look around, and there was just a sea of people. And I mean, your worst fears start to set in. You're thinking, did somebody take him, or is he hurt, or what's going on? And so we immediately begin to kind of split up, and we start looking for him all over the place. And eventually, after about 10 to 15 minutes, which seemed like the longest 10 to 15 minutes of my life, Chad ended up finding him at a first aid station. What had happened was that he had, as we were walking, he had started to he saw along the way, saw this fancy, shiny red Coke machine. And he thought, that's what I want, that's what I'm all about. And so he wandered off, he didn't tell anybody, and all of a sudden that distraction split him up from us. And that's a whole nother sermon, by the way. I think I could use that for something else. But it split him up from us. And although throughout that day and throughout the previous days that we had with him as our son, anytime we were apart from each other, whenever we would come back together, it was always good. It was always hugs. It was always, we know, we're glad to see you. But that day and at that time, when we saw him, he just wrapped his arms around us. He was so afraid and so scared. If you can imagine being, you know, 5 or 6 and then being separated from your family for the very first time, he didn't know if he was ever going to see us again. And so that day, the hug was a little bit tighter. And he didn't want to leave us so quickly after that day. You see, what he experienced there was he experienced a bit of loss in his short little life that all of a sudden made our relationship much, much sweeter and better to him in that moment. And it took a really hard and a really difficult thing for him to experience that. I tell you that story today because I want to get you thinking about this question. Why did God allow humanity to experience the tragedy of death? Why did God allow that? I mean, I'm not asking, like, how did it happen? I think if you've been in church for any period of time or you've studied the Bible, you know that it happened because of sin. The reason we experience death is all because of sin. But why did he allow us to experience such a difficult thing? You see, all of us, I think most of us, have experienced death in some way, shape, or form. Many of us have experienced the death of a loved one, a family member, or a friend, and it's painful. It's difficult to kind of wrap your mind around that, about what's happening and why it happened. But that's not the only type of death that we experience. You see, there are many types of death that we experience in this life. Some of you have experienced the death of a relationship. There are people in this room that have been divorced. They've experienced their family maybe cutting them off or walking away from them or disowning them. And there's a relationship that's been fractured. Maybe it's between a friendship where a friendship that you had has been broken and it's irreconcilable and you've never been able to come together again. And the relationship is completely broken. There's death in the relationships sometimes that we have. What about the death of a career or a business? Some of us have experienced that, where we've put all of our energy and our time into something. We've invested ourselves only to find out years down the road that everything that we put all of our effort into fell short. It just went away. All of a sudden, it was over. We're left wondering, do we still have value? Are we still worth something? Do we still have purpose in this life? Happens whenever we experience that type of death. What about the death of our finances or our dreams? Some of us have experienced those kinds of death, and they can be just as real. When we realize that the opportunities that we were hoping for, the things that we had in our lives that we were trying to hold on to, that we were just praying would happen, all of a sudden one day, we realize they're never going to happen. Maybe they're stolen from us. Maybe they're taken from us outside of our own doing, or maybe we did something to ruin them. We experience death in that way. And every one of us, the older we are, the more we experience this, we experience the death of our own bodies. It's slow and painful. I know I'm experiencing that every day. I can't do the same things that I've always done. I don't have the energy that I used to have. Some of us were facing health issues, maybe disease, and we're faced with this reality, this very real reality of death. See, death is painful. It's incredibly painful, and it's painful because the death of anything that we hold dear, it's so painful because it's permanent. There's no coming back from death. We know that it's the ultimate end. There's no return. And over the last few weeks, we've been in a series called Jesus Is, where we've been looking at these I am statements in the Gospel of John, where Jesus talks about who he really is. He's identifying himself with God in that gospel. And he starts to recalibrate with those statements what our understandings are and what our views of God are. And throughout this series, what I've been using is this box to kind of illustrate the boxes that we build in our minds, the things that we have, the presuppositions that we have in our minds that aren't necessarily true when it comes to us and God and the way that we view the world. You see, we come to the way we think by a bunch of different ways. Some of those are by our experiences. Sometimes we come to those ways by what a family member told us or what a pastor said or something that we heard in religion or something that our culture tells us. And the truth is that many of our presuppositions, the ones that we use to guide our life, actually they create a box in our mind. And in fact, we end up letting these boxes guide us through life when the truth is that most of that box is false. And we keep following it, and we keep letting it guide us, even though there's not a lot of truth in it. But when it comes to death, I think we can get especially trapped in a mental box. That box doesn't really do a great job, I think, of illustrating that. But today I have a different box that I think really helps us kind of get that view. It's this box. I can hear all of you the moment that I uncovered that. There's something that you think in the moment. See, regardless of what you think about that box, all of us have an emotional reaction to it. Every one of us does. In fact, when they delivered this earlier this week, I had an emotional reaction to it. I was like, man, I don't know what I think about this. I'm kind of questioning some of my decision making. Especially when the guy who delivered it said, hey, Wes, when we're done with this, you could buy it. I could sell it to you. And I said, man, no way. That's the last thing I need. Right? It's okay. We can lighten the mood just a little bit. But regardless of what you think when you see this, the truth is that we have these reactions because that's the power of death that it has over us. We associate that box with death. And we become enslaved and we become trapped by it. See, that casket represents the mental box that many of us get trapped in whenever we're forced to deal with death. And some of you, just seeing that box today, it brings back this well of emotion, maybe from 20 years ago, maybe from 2 weeks ago. And as we look at that, it is a real reminder of something that every one of us has to deal with in life. We can't get away from it. We can't try to escape it. And the fact is that death is the box that traps and enslaves us more than any other, because so often it drives a wedge between us and God. That's what happens in death. It drives a wedge because anytime we experience any kind of death in our life, whether it's relational, financial, or physical, we begin to think things like, how could God love me and allow me to experience this type of pain and suffering, this much pain and suffering in my life? How could he do that if he's a God of love? And we begin to ask questions that create more of a gap between us and him. We think things like, how can God be powerful if he can't overcome the death of my mother, or the death of my child, or the death of my dreams? Or we think, how can God be good if he allowed me to lose my job, or my house, or my grandmother? See, any time death occurs in our life, there's a choice, there's an opportunity for us to come closer to God or for us to be separated from him. And most often what happens is there's a wedge that's driven between him and us, because we begin to blame him for taking something from us. That's what we do often, isn't it? In death, we start to blame him for taking something away. When the truth is that God is the author of life. He's not the author of death. And in fact, maybe, just maybe, he uses death as an opportunity to draw us to him in a very unique and a very special way. See, I think knowing the tragedy of death is what makes the resurrection so incredible. It's what reveals Jesus' glory in a very unique way. Death is the reason that the resurrection is so sweet. And it's why the resurrection reveals Christ's glory and compels us to belief. Because it's so out of the ordinary. It's not something that happens every day. It's not something that you and I can overcome. It's something that we're all facing. And at the end of the day, we can't control what happens. We have to deal with it. That's why the resurrection is so important. This morning, I want to look at a passage of Scripture in John chapter 11. It's a resurrection story. It's not the resurrection story of Christ. What I would call it is, it's kind of a precursor to the resurrection of Christ. Some of you know this story in John chapter 11. It's the story of the death and resurrection of Lazarus. And it's in that story that we can actually see the truth behind why death occurs, why God has used it for us and for our, how he uses it for us and for our benefit. So if you're not familiar with that story, I'll just walk you through it, and you can see what God does in this miraculous event. So there was a man named Lazarus, and just so you kind of get a little context, it wasn't just any man that he came upon. Jesus was actually very good friends with Lazarus and his sisters. He had two sisters, Mary and Martha. In fact, they lived in a place called Bethany, which wasn't far from Jerusalem. And Jesus, we know, enjoyed this place. This was a place of refuge. It was a place where he would go to be encouraged. In fact, in the New Testament, we see that he traveled to Bethany about 11 different times just in the course of 3 short years. And I'm sure there were many other times that weren't attested to. But we know that Jesus had a very significant relationship with Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. He loved spending time there. They encouraged him. They built him up. And so he went there often. So one time when Jesus is away, Lazarus gets sick. And the two sisters, they send a message to Jesus telling him that his friend, that his very dear friend, is sick. But when Jesus heard about it, this is what he says. He says, Lazarus' sickness will not end in death. No, it happened for the glory of God, so that the Son of God will receive glory from this. And then we see it says, so although Jesus loved Martha, Mary, and Lazarus, he stayed where he was for the next 2 days. I mean, just think about this for a moment. We already know that Jesus loves Mary and Martha and Lazarus. But when he hears Lazarus is sick, he doesn't come running. He stays where he is. He keeps doing what he's doing for 2 more days. Then he says, after these couple of days to his disciples, he says this, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but now I'll go and wake him up. His disciples said, Lord, if he's sleeping, he'll get better soon. And they thought that Jesus meant that Lazarus was simply sleeping. But what Jesus was getting at is that Lazarus had actually died. So he told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. And listen to this. He continues, he says, Lazarus is dead, and for your sakes, I'm glad I wasn't there. For now you will really believe. Come, let's go see him. I think when we read this passage and we see what's going on, it's almost hard to believe. You're thinking, well, Jesus, you could have gone to Lazarus. And yet he willfully decides not to go. And he decides not to go because what he's saying is to his disciples that there's a greater purpose. There's a bigger purpose than him just rushing to the rescue of Lazarus. And I don't know about you, but how many times have you ever been in a situation where you were facing the death of something? And you knew it was coming. You could see it like a freight train coming down the track. And you're praying and you're asking God, God, stop it. God, would you just come and fix it? How many of you have been there? I have. How many of you have been there when Jesus didn't come? I have. Jesus didn't come. He didn't stop the thing that they were asking him to come and fix. But it wasn't because he didn't love them. It was because there was a greater purpose. There was something bigger going on. We find out that Jesus, when he makes it to Bethany, he's told when he arrives that Lazarus has already been in his grave for 4 days. And when Martha got word that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him, but Mary stayed in the house. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had only been here when my brother, if you had only been here, my brother would not have died. There's the blame. Right out of the gate, she doesn't say hello. She doesn't say glad to see you. The first thing she does is say, why weren't you here? If you were here, my brother would still be alive. We wouldn't have had to face death. Then she says this, but even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus told her, her brother will rise again. He says, your brother will rise again. And yes, Martha says, he'll rise when everyone else rises at the last day. First of all, we find out that Lazarus has been dead for 4 days. This just means that he's not in a coma. He's not sleeping like he's really dead. There is no doubt about the fact that Lazarus has expired. But what I find interesting here is that as soon as Jesus shows up, like I said, she starts to blame Jesus. She's saying, why weren't you here? And all of a sudden what we see is we see that blame start to happen and that box starts getting created in her mind. She starts to build up her presuppositions about what's good and what's not good, and she starts to wrestle with the tension of what's actually going on. I think you actually see it in this text, because on one time she's saying, why weren't you here? And she's saying, but I know you could fix it. I know you can do anything. And Jesus is saying, your brother's going to rise. And she's like, I know, in the end, in the last days, right? Right? She's wrestling. She's in this tension like, I know I'm supposed to know that God's good and he's over everything. And I know Jesus loves us and he says that he's God and he supposedly can do all these things, but he didn't do what he said, what I thought he would do. And what does that mean? See, we've all been in that place, haven't we? Where we're trying to wrestle between, I know God is good, or I'm supposed to know he's good, but what I'm walking through doesn't feel good. That's where she is. That's the place that she's in. And that box just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger in her mind. Then Jesus says this. He says, I am the resurrection and life. Anyone who believes in me will live, even after dying. Everyone who lives in me and believes in me will never, ever die. Do you believe this, Martha? That's what Jesus asked her. In this moment, she has no idea what Jesus, I think, is saying. I don't think she gets it. I think she knows that Jesus is the Son of God. In fact, she's going to say that in a moment. But she doesn't, I think, really grasp. Jesus is saying, I'm not just the guy who can heal every once in a while or when I show up, because that's, I think, how they view him. They think death's too big even for him. He's saying, I am the resurrection and the life. He's not saying, I can provide resurrection. He's saying, I'm it. If you look at the beginning of the Gospel of John, what does it say? That Jesus himself is life. That everything that was created through him. Everything. He holds all life in his hands, and that means that he holds the power of not just life, but the power of resurrection. All of it lies in him. And he says, you just have to believe, Martha. And she's probably thinking again, like she said, well, maybe that's off one day, that doesn't help me today. She has no idea what Jesus is about to do. She's still caught up in that box. And the box of death that we know we're trapped in. She knew it too. And Martha responds to him. She says, yes, Lord. I've always believed that you're the Messiah, the Son of God, the one who's come into the world from God. And then she went and she returns to her sister Mary. She tells him, hey, the teacher wants to see you. And so Mary then immediately goes out to him. And when she arrives, she says almost verbatim what her sister says. She falls at his feet and she says, Lord, if you'd only been here, my brother would not have died. She's living in that box too. She's so trapped by what she believes and what she thinks and all that she knows of death. I mean, you can't blame her, right? She thinks it's all over. It's done. And she's blaming him as well. When Jesus saw her weeping and he saw the other people wailing with her, a deep anger, it says, welled up within him, and he was deeply troubled. He says, where have you put him? They told him, Lord, come and see. And Jesus begins to weep. He starts to cry. And the people who were watching this, they said, see how much that he loved him. And then some said, this man healed a blind man. Couldn't he have kept Lazarus from dying? And although Jesus was still troubled, when he arrives at the tomb, a cave with a stone rolled across its entrance where Lazarus was buried. We're about to see this miracle happen, but nobody knows it's about to happen. All we see is that both sisters, both of Lazarus's family members, even the people, the townspeople, they're like, this guy, if he would have just come, He could have fixed it, and he didn't. They're all living in the box. Every single one of them. They all put the blame on him, even though he's the creator of life. And here's what I would just make sure that we don't miss in these couple of verses. Whatever you're going through, whatever you're walking in, whatever death experience that you've lived through or you're walking in or you will walk through, can I just tell you, God is not happy about it. He cares deeply for every single one of us. And I think the beautiful part of what we see in this passage is that Jesus actually weeps over the death of Lazarus. I think what we're seeing is the fact that he's weeping, not because he knows that he's about to raise him, but he's weeping over the fact that sin has come in the door and it's broken humanity so much that we have to experience the most painful things of our lives that he never intended us to experience. And he's sitting there weeping with them in the moment. It's so compassionate. It's full of empathy. Don't take that for granted. Whatever you're going through, whatever you've gone through, God isn't sitting back. He's not happy about it. He doesn't love to have you under his thumb. He doesn't love to punish his people. That's not what this is about. He knows that at the end of the day, he's allowed things to happen, but he's allowed them to happen for a good and great purpose. It's not to torture you. It's not to keep you separated. It's not because he likes seeing you in pain and suffering. And then we get to the beautiful end of this story. Jesus says this. He says, roll the stone aside. And Martha, I love this. It just makes the scriptures, I think, so real. She protests. She says, Lord, he's been dead for 4 days. It's going to stink. The smell's going to be horrible. Again, no idea what's going on, what's about to happen. And he responds, didn't I tell you that you would see God's glory if you believe? So they roll the stone aside. Then Jesus looked up to heaven and he said, Father, thank you for hearing me. You've always heard me, but I said it out loud for the sake of all these people standing here so that they will believe you sent me. Then Jesus shouted, Lazarus, come out. And the dead man came out. Amen, right? He walks out. It says that his body's still wrapped in grave clothes around his hands and his feet. His head is still wrapped. And he says, unwrap him and let him go. I mean, it's almost unbelievable, isn't it? That that actually happened. That Jesus has the power over death, that he came to save Lazarus. Can I tell you that he didn't just come to save Lazarus, he came to save you and me as well. That's what his resurrection was about. That day it was about Lazarus, and about a little over a week, it was about all of you and me. To fix it once and for all. To restore us to the life that he always meant us to have. He overcame death permanently in the resurrection. But he allowed Lazarus to die so that he would be glorified and more people would believe. That's what we cannot miss. That he allowed something painful and bad and horrible to happen so that he could save more. Whatever death that you've walked through in your life, I promise you there's something that God wants to do with it in your life. It wasn't just so you could experience more pain and more suffering. He's using it for something greater. See, it's impossible to experience the glory of Jesus in the resurrection without knowing the tragedy of death. Because nothing reveals Christ's glory and compels us to belief like resurrection. And here's the response. There's a response there. When we come face to face with the resurrection, the response is belief. That's what Jesus says here. It's what he tells Mary and Martha. He says, do you believe? He asked them multiple times. The response is believe. And today, I don't know what you believe. I don't know if you believe in the resurrection. But what we're talking about and what Jesus is calling you to in this kind of belief, it's not blind faith. Can I just tell you that? We don't not just call to believe blindly. We believe based on evidence. Did you know that the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus, that there is more evidence for that than most of the ancient historical things that we know about today? But yet, many people don't want to believe because it comes down to a decision. When you're faced with the resurrection, you have to decide, am I going to walk in faith and believe it? Am I going to put my faith in Jesus? Am I going to receive the life that he's offering? And can I tell you that when we do that, when we receive that life, that it's not just a belief that maybe in the ways that we think about belief where we say a prayer. I know churches in over years recently have said, oh, just pray a prayer and you'll be saved. Well, that's really not true, and it's actually not what the text says here. That word believe that Jesus says in verses 25 and 26, it's the Greek word pistuo. It's a verb. It means to believe, trust, or entrust. It describes the act of believing or trusting something. It's an action. And Jesus says in verse 26, he says, the one who lives and believes in me will never die. You know what it is to live in Christ? It's just what we mean when we say to repent, right? We have to turn. That's all that means, that we turn and we follow him. That at the end of the day, we see Christ for who he is. We put our faith and our trust in him. By the way, that's the beginning. We don't have to know everything to begin that relationship. It's the beginning. He says, turn towards me. And as you begin to follow me, that's when you receive me. That's when I become your Savior. I save you from that. There's more to the resurrection than just eternal life. I would be doing you a disservice to just end in the fact that this is all about gaining life in the future. It's about that. It's about living with Jesus forever in eternity. But truth be told, if we just have more of this life eternally, that doesn't seem like much of a blessing. See, when we see everything in light of the resurrection, what we're told and what Jesus says, he says, I am making all things new. He says, those who are in Christ, in 1 Corinthians 5, he says, whoever puts their faith, 2 Corinthians 5, he says, whoever puts their faith in me, whoever's in me, I'm making everything new. I'm not keeping it old. If you go to Revelation 21, what do we see? We see that when the new heaven and the new earth come, he says that he's making everything new, that there will be no more tears, there will be no more sorrow, nor more pain. Everything gets a do-over in Christ. Everything. So here's what that means. It means that we will get to see people that we love. Yes, it means that. That if they are in Christ and we're in Christ, that we'll see them again in eternity. That we don't lose that. But here's the crazier thing. I think this is much crazier than that. The crazy thing is that because of the resurrection, that all of our hopes, all of our dreams, everything that was put to death in this life, everything that we didn't get to see the fulfillment of, all of the death of relationships, the death of our finances, the death of all those of all the people, the shame, the guilt, the regret, the things that you secretly look back on and you still weep over because it's gone. Here's what Christ does with all of it. This is what he does. He says, look, it's over. It's over. And the grave is empty. There's nothing stuck in this box anymore. He's freed us. He's broken the lid off the box that all of us experience, that we get trapped in. And this is why we praise the name of Jesus. It's why we don't stop singing. It's why every time we come to Easter, we celebrate. And even before, like we're like, man, I have to praise him. I have to lift him up. It's a response. We praise his name. Praise the name of Jesus because he conquered the grave and that box is empty. Praise him. Let's sing together.
Praise 'cause you reign.